Hello, I'm Kate Thomas, and this is At Home Radio, a podcast about feeling at home where we are, whether in our own space or out in the world. Today, my guest is Sarah Cass, head coach and owner of Cyrano's Place Fencing Club. So this is a fencing club that teaches fencing. Is Cyrano's Place open now during the pandemic?
Yes, we are. We were allowed to open by Governor DeWine's authority right after Memorial Day, and we did. We've been doing certain things to keep things safe. Obviously, the cleaning protocols and so on. But in addition, we're cleaning off our own personal equipment. We're cleaning the team equipment. It's getting washed, et cetera, et cetera. And we're keeping groups to no more than 9, which including me makes 10, socially distancing in there. And even with our equipment, this is one of the pieces, very important pieces of equipment, our face cover. And inside here, I've got, you can maybe see a facial cover within my mask, so that when we start huffing and puffing, that even though DeWine has said athletes do not have to wear face covers while doing things, we're keeping our breathing clouds to ourselves. Because like in any community, you have people who are at risk, and I want them to be welcome and comfortable and so on, because our basic principle at Cyrano's Place is that everybody is welcome as long as there is respect. That's very important to me. I think it's very important everywhere. I think it's part of whatever healing we can do, that respect is number one. I don't care if you do or do not like somebody, but if you respect them, we can deal with each other.
Okay. That sounds good. And also, when you say that there are all kinds of people who come to Cyrano's Place, you and I talked, of course, before this podcast, and I was surprised how accessible fencing is to people. You told me that you can take an 80-year-old and teach that 80-year-old how to fence and train that person to be able to enjoy competing on a local / regional level, which is amazing.
Absolutely. And that's one of the beauties of fencing as a sport. It is such an equalizer. I'm a mere 5'1", and I can tell you that in each of the three disciplines that is the sport of fencing, I've taken out 6'2" guys. Okay, yes, they'll accuse me about being an ankle biter, but it's more like about
yep, yep, yep. Sorry, go on.
The real truth of the matter is with fencing, it's about smarts. And anybody can be smart. Your physicality does not define how intelligent, how logical, how capable you are. When fencing was still, when women were first invited to be part of the Olympic Games, fencing was one of the few sports they participated in. And on the Paralympic level, fencing is the only combat sport. And I got to tell you, some of these Paralympics are absolute beasts. There's a new movie out on Netflix called Phoenix Rising about Paralympians. And there's Scal Bibi from Italy is, oh my God, fierce. There are plenty of able-bodied fencers who wish they were as awesome as she was. But it's such an equalizer on that art. We as able-bodied can envy and look up to wheelchair. And me as a middle-aged, middle-class woman, short, stumpy woman, can take out 6-foot-something guys.
Incredible.
You can't say that about any other sport. You really can't. So yeah. It's the ultimate in an equalizer. Even collegiately, there's no separate men's and women's team title. It's a combined. So the men cheer on the women cheer on the men. They train intimately together at practices because they need each other. And then the team title is the combination. So it's the ultimate in a Title IX sport, which again is one of my attractions to this.
Okay, so you've been fencing for how long?
I've been fencing for over 40 years now. It's kind of my DNA at this point.
So what attracted you to fencing in the first place?
Well, I've always been a tomboy, rolling around in mud, climbing trees. And my sister came home one summer, and she'd started fencing in college. I'm like, any sport she can do, I can do better. I'm an obnoxious little sister. Well, she stopped dating the captain of the men's team, and here I am over four decades later. I will say that when I got the first foil put in my hand, the feel of it, the bend of it, the absence, I felt complete, because I felt like I'd been missing a part of my body until I put my foil in my hand. Wow. I don't know how many people can say that about their sport.
That is wonderful. Well, I just have to, this is a little aside, but one of my all-time favorite plays is Cyrano de Bergerac. And that is about a Frenchman who, you know, he got into a lot of duels mostly because of the insults he received all the time over the size of his very large nose. So anyway, and Steve Martin, of course, updated the play with Roxanne, which was also a favorite movie. So it's a wonderful, and fencing is so colorful with its terminology, you know, touche and on guard and everything else. I mean, there is a romance to fencing, isn't there?
Actually, it's funny you should mention Cyrano de Bergerac, because that is partially where we get our name. Being a small woman and a feisty little person, the hummingbird is my personal totem. And when I was looking to find a name, I was like, what says fencing without the word fencing in it? And I played around with the words and I played around with the language and I came up with Cyrano's place. Now, it happens that I'm also a writer, and it happens that a lot of my fencers are writers, wannabe writers. So it happens that there's a lot of wordsmithing that goes on in and around practice, because mm-hmm. the kind of creativity that is an important asset to writing well is the creativity you need and want to mm-hmm. be an effective fencer, even if you're not that athletic or that skilled. And you can compensate with creative thought process.
Yes. Oh, that's wonderful. So that was going to be one of my questions. Was Cyrano de Bergerac an inspiration for Cyrano's place? Was there another reason as well for it, for the name?
Because I wanted to use the hummingbird as its totem, and the hummingbird has a long nose like Cyrano.
Oh, that's excellent.
And actually, I understand the Spanish word for hummingbird is el sereno.
Oh, well, there you go. That must be where Edmond Rostand, or whatever his name was, who wrote it in the first place in the play back in the 1600s, I think, something like that. So anyway, this is great.
The book is actually in our front window. One of the original publications. Somehow I inherited it and I opened it up, you know, and it's I've got Rostand's Cyrano in my front page. Oh, and I do speak some French. Je parle un peu français.
Un peu is what I definitely, in fact, I was trying to figure out how to say, and then I finally looked it up, saber, a fencer who uses a saber. And
that's cream de saber. Get roll the R.
Yeah, so yeah. Well, no.
Je fais de l'escrime. J'aime le fleuret et j'aime le sabre. I said, I am a fencer. I love the foil and I love the saber.
Yes. Okay. And those are two of the kinds of fencing that people do. So you might as well tell us about those.
Well, this is a foil. The bell guard is a little bit smaller. You hit with the point. Look, Ma, no blood. You have what's called right of way, which means the first person makes an attack. The other one must acknowledge the attack with a blocking action or a parry before they can attack back. A lot of the terms in fencing are French terms. The second discipline is, the French for that is le fleuret. The second discipline is the épée or l'épée or sword. This is the heaviest of our three weapons. Target area, or the bell guard is the largest. Again, we hit with the point. Target area is the full body, so it's whoever hits first because it's the descendant of the dueling weapon. And the third is our lightest of the three, or the saber. Again, you can hit with the point, but unlike the foil and épée, you can also hit with the side blade. Look, Ma, still no blood. Targaryen saber is from the waist up. It comes from cavalry saber. You didn't want to hit your opponent's horse. So you took the fencer off the horse and we went at it. It happens that the first U.S. Women's Saber National Championship was held in 1988. And I was a finalist in that first national championship. And I got to tell you, even after I had not one, but two national medals in saber, I still had people tell me, oh, it's not a woman's and saber.
It's not a
and or I won't fence
not
your
a
saber
sport for women then. So yeah, what is that?
But I got to tell you, in 2004, at the Athens Olympics, women's saber became one of the an event. Finally, U.S. women took gold and bronze, and the following Olympics, U.S. swept the individual medals. And every time I host an event where I have Y10 women's saber, I know that all my grief was worth it.
That's great. So you were very much, you helped bring competition for women in saber. You helped it along. Congratulations.
And actually, thank you. I'm starting to work on a video project for our YouTube channel. It's the Cyrano's Place YouTube channel, which is the history of women's saber as well as women's épée in the U.S. Because the women's épée, and I haven't pinpointed the year, the first national championship was like 80-82, and I'm pinpointing that because they'd had trainer tournaments or demonstration events up until that point, and get in contact with those women. I was a finalist, as I said, in 88, and contact those women and see how their experience was and kind of document the changes that we pioneers were able to implement. Unfortunately, there are a couple of the major movers and shakers in the sport and influential in getting it have now died from complications due to old age. But we want to also remember these women who helped us continue to open up the door for these amazing young women who are, oh my God, if you look on the World Cup level of women's saber, these women are absolute beasts. Oh my God. It's like, there is an ad out there of one of the gals who's on the U.S. Olympic team in saber, and she's getting out there, her hands going, and she's doing this beautiful, magnificent lunge. And at the same time she starts, the car next to her starts, and this guy floors it. She's ahead of the car, hitting 60 miles per hour.
That's, well, okay. So why?
Unfortunately, not me, but...
So why did you start Cyrano's Place in the first place? And when was it? How long ago did you open it?
Well, as a kid, I swore I would never grow up to be a fencing coach. So obviously, I haven't grown up never mind. I'd been living in New York City. I'd gone to college in Manhattan, did the whole NCAA thing, made NCAA national, stayed out there to keep training. And I woke up one day and a series of events brought me back to Cleveland to continue my education to become a certified athletic trainer at Baldwin Wallace. And while I was at Baldwin Wallace, I was helping the woman who was teaching the fencing class. And she came up to me at one point and said, I have a private citizen who'd like to take fencing, but I can't have her in this class because it's a private university. Take her number and do it. And I called her up. I said, find me a location. So she did, at the West Park YMCA. And I started teaching there, and I had this great class. And one of the kids in there, the parents of a kid said, have you heard of the Beck Center for the Arts? I'm like, well, I'm an East Sider, so no. But shortly after that, I discovered what the Beck Center was. It was an awesome organization. And I moved into the Beck Center for the Arts. And that took the program and just exploded it. I'm like, okay. I think we got something here because I'm a poor college student and I could use the income. What the hey? And all of a sudden I woke up one day and was like, wait a minute. I like this. I'm having fun. This might be a sustainable business. Mm-hmm. In the summer of 2000, when my father, who is a second generation entrepreneur, finally decided to retire, gave me some of his office furniture and gave me some seed money, and I started Cyrano's Place, August of 2000, on Madison Avenue, right next to the police department, which caused some interesting issues. You know, people walking past the police station with swords.
Yes, I'm sure. And this is in Lakewood, Ohio.
We then would move to our current location, which is on Madison. We have more square footage. We've got more space. The facility's air conditioned. We have a lounge. We have an armory. We have everything you might want for an awesome experience in fencing. And we even have, as of recently, because of one of my kids, going for his Eagle Scout Award, created a trainer. Because the problem is, I also coach at Rocky River, and we have me, 20-some kids, two electric scoring machines, and not enough continuous activities. So he created this three-weapon home trainer for us. So we have these at the club. We've been trying them out, and actually they're awesome for social distancing and training because the students can work on this. I can keep them 6-7 feet apart, and I can work with each person individually as they practice their drills without having to do all the face covers and so on. So we have these home trainers. We've got targets. And what's been really cool, you know, the silver lining, if you will, be with COVID, is taking all these pieces, parts, creating videos, which I've been able to share to other fencers who are stuck at home, because one of the most important things about anything you're doing isn't necessarily excelling right here, right now, but still keeping your head in the game. And that's a tough one right now, especially when we're stuck at home and we can't go anything. Well, if you can't go anything, let me bring the fencing to you. So I'm taking my expertise. I've got a video on how to make a target with materials that cost less than $5. We now have this fencing trainer that materials, including PVC, are probably less than $20. And you can take it apart and put it in, collapse it so it's about like this thick and about this wide and fit in your closet. Because Rocky River, we have limited storage space. So if I'm going to have these, I can break them down. So as many of my kids want to use them, we can store them, and life is great. Now all we have to do is get back on stripping competitions, but we're working on that too.
Right, right. So your videos are, I really like how they're instructional. You even have this one about how women can wear, should wear their hair, you know, underneath the, you know, helmet and everything. They're also quite inspirational with the stories of different athletes. And I love the humor in them. I really just love how you interject things. So we're doing, on that point, let's talk about, let me get the name of it right here, Brotherly Love and Donuts, or Go Fence with Cyrano's Place. It premiered on your channel on August 27th. And during it, and you've got these two young fencers, I really want to hear about them, and they're dueling over donuts, and but you have these disclaimers pop up cartoon style in the video. No, this actually isn't how it's done. But tell us about the whole making of this fun video.
Well, Jaleel called me and said, "Hey, I want a fence." I'm like, "Okay."
This is right one now, of the stars, young man, Jaleel, two young men.
Jaleel is the man with the longer dreads. And actually, when he first walked in my door, I was like almost starstruck because he's got just a little goatee and mustard. I mean, he looks like
cute, even with the his pandemic mask on. Go on.
Jaleel looks like a reincarnation of Alexandre Dumas. Now, I don't know if you know anything about Alexandre Dumas, but Alexandre Dumas was half black. From the Dark Continent himself. So he had that swarthy look, but not really dark. And just that nice cafe au lait complexion. Well, Jaleel has it too. So Jaleel is a very handsome kid, and his dreadlocks are just well managed and manicured. And it's like, ooh, you know. And he's like, well, my friend.
Star quality to him.
He definitely does. And he is one of the sweetest people who've crossed my path. It's just sweet. He's got this smile that's just sweet. There's nothing else to tell you. And he's like, well, my friend Lewis wants to fence too. I'm like, cool. So the two of them show up and, you know, working with him, getting to know him, and they're kind of bantering back and forth. Well, interestingly, Lewis can only train for a few weeks because he's got to go back to Temple where he's a PhD student. And I'm like, you're smarter than me, dude. You know, hey, I'm a graduate student dropout. If you're going to drop out of school, wait till grad school. That's cool.
Advice.
Gonna drop out of school, wait till grad school. So, you know, we're doing this and the two of them are just goofing off. And I'm like, wait a minute, this would be really cool. So I'm like, okay, let's figure out a conflict. And we figured it out. We basically took a 30-second kind of orientation of what was going on and choreography. And I said, let's go. And they totally improv the whole thing. They improvised the whole thing. And I'm watching this and I'm like, you know, for it. Well, I got to tell you, with this, there are a couple really awesome healing things that happen. There's a woman from Australia who was on the Australian Olympic team who has been fighting the after effects of COVID. She's unhealthy. She's sick. She's weak. She can't even walk, you know, a half quarter of a mile without being totally spent from what she's posting. And I message her. I'm like, watch this, because you need a laugh. This should be healing. And she responds back to me, oh my God, that was hilarious. It's just what the doctor ordered. Aww. I've got, there's been a whole bunch of discussion with the BLM and the gap in terms of what the white community understands and what the BLM is fighting for. And part of that is an environment like fencing doesn't have a lot of diversity of faces. I mean, historically, it's a very white environment. Cleveland is one of the few cities historically that had diversity historically, you know, as such. We've had a couple Olympians of color. Jason Pryor, who is 2016 Olympian, is of color. He's from South Euclid. I have an interview with him, and he's also a delightful guy with awesome dreadlocks. Oh my God, he's our dreadlocks. Oh my God, they're beautiful. I have a thing for dreadlocks. I think they're handsome. Well, I just like long hair and guys. That's my fetish. But we've got, there's two coaches in town who've been fencing for as long, if not longer than me. The coach from Shaker, Will Wheeler, actually put the first foil in my hand when I was 12 and he was 10. And he's now coaching at Shaker. There's a fellow, Fred Sims, who's now starting to get his own club going. He was at our wedding because of a faux pas with wedding planning. I ended up sitting with him and his kids for our wedding. Yeah. Point being, there are people of color in Northern Ohio historically. But if you go outside of Northern Ohio and you go outside of Manhattan, it gets very pasty out there. So one of the comments has been that when you go out, if you are of color and you go out and you don't see people who look like you, it's kind of intimidating. So part of it is to start showing that this is really accessible to anyone and everybody who wants to. And as far as I'm concerned, at Cyrano's place, anybody and everyone who's respectful is welcome. So one of the things that happened is I have another black student. He's turning 10. And he saw the video with Jason Pryor, and you could see him going, cool, this could be me.
Oh, he saw himself.
And I told him to watch Brotherly Love and Donuts. And he loved it because, again, he sees faces that say, you are welcome, versus what we've had with the Women's Saver, for instance, told, you can't do this, you're not allowed to. You know, and if they're doing it to me as a woman, I can only imagine from an experiential standpoint what people of color are experiencing with this kind of bias, because it's more acceptable for women to do things than people who are different to do things. And that is totally unacceptable. Mm-hmm. So my goal is to try and help this from a like Spike Lee-ish kind of way, mm-hmm. where I don't say, hey, BLM, because that's not going to help, because right now everybody is so hurt and so angry that life's kind of like raising a teenage child. You're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. And even when you're right, you're still wrong because nothing you do can be right because everybody's having a knee-jerk reaction. So yeah. I'm just going to throw it out there for things like brotherly love and donuts. We have a couple other adventures for our hero, Jaleel,
all right,
to do, which include gaining his superpower through donuts.
He likes those donuts.
That at least is our goal. I mean, because I want to make his path towards competition excellence a path that is the boy next door, ultimately. In this case, he's got more melanin than maybe your boy next door. But he really is one of the sweetest people in the world. Actually, one of the things about Jaleel that I didn't know until after I started getting things for the video, he was part of a program in Cleveland called Distinguished Gentlemen, which took some of the inner city Cleveland public boys and helped them learn things like learning how to tie a tie to how to present poetry in Shakespeare.
It's great.
And really give them literary culture. And Jaleel was definitely somebody who was worthy of getting this, and his poise and his diction and his presentation is wonderful. Hey, anybody want to put him in your movie? I would love to see him on the big screen. I would love to see him eventually in the big screen. No, and to tell you the truth, if I can help him get there, it's like, I'll do it.
Absolutely. And he'll know how to fence. You know, he'll be ready for those duels on screen.
He sings. I've heard recordings. He's got a band. He's got a sweet voice, too.
He really sounds like he's an all-around talent. So, Sarah, you have such enthusiasm and for teaching and for fencing. Just everything about your long career in this field. So what is it? What do you love about fencing?
Well, there's so many things. And I've been trying to evaluate this because another one of my adults who's a writer has been doing stories and trying to give him the right context. I think one of the beauties of fencing is there's a certain adrenaline rush. Somebody's trying to kill you. However, you're not going to get hurt because fencing is one of the safest Olympic sports, according to the National Athletic Trainers Association. But you can live this life and death situation for the adrenaline rush. So I find that it's very common that fencers are definitely adrenaline junkies on one level or another, but not necessarily risk takers, because you've got risk takers. If you're a risk taker, you're going out skydiving, you know? And actually, one of my students who's in college has become a serious skydiver, and he wants to be an ER doctor. Can you say adrenaline rush?
No kidding.
But you know, you've got others, especially in the what's called veteran women's, vet being 40 and over events, like masters in other events, who are low risk takers. They are not risk takers, but they are adrenaline junkies. And when you get into a group of people who are in certain ways like-minded in the sense of intelligent, confident, capable, creative, and puzzle solvers, and then you go tete-a-tete with them, it's a wonderful thing. And I think the other beauty is I get to fight somebody, and when I'm done, I can shake their hand and say, thank you very much for beating me up. You know?
It all reminds me, in an athletic way, of being a chess master, you know, because you need to know how to defeat your opponent on many levels.
Fencing is described as an athletic chess.
I did not know that. That's it. But just hearing you just say it the way you did, it's like, wow. Very cool.
Athletic chess. We have discussions on the club level and the national level. Where do we find other potential fencers? And the truth of the matter is your average fencer is not mainstream. We're not going to grab the pizza and the chicken wings and watch the football game on Saturday afternoon as our highlight of our week, because that's too mundane for us. We are looking for that which is different, unique, special, you know, not to say we don't chill out and watch the football game on Sunday afternoons. We've had to move many a board meeting because of the dang football game on Sunday afternoons, but
well, probably not this fall.
But fencers are just a little bit different. You find them in things that are intellectually stimulating. And actually, you know, you've got all these parents who've got kids who are doing all these video games. I was like, get off the damn video box, kids. And they get into the fencing. It's like, ooh, this is cool. I get to live it, not just watch it with my thumbs. But it's the same kind of intellectual puzzle, adrenaline game that attracts people to video games, mm-hmm. live action, LARPing, and stuff like that. There's a certain romantic quality to winning and competing. I think on one level for me, I've always been a very competitive person. I'm also the least competitive in my family, which is why I can compete. Because if you're too competitive, you eat yourself up.
Okay.
But I like competing for competition's sake. I like winning too, but winning isn't the end all. Mm-hmm. I'd rather be able to say, yeah, my result sucks, but damn, I fenced well. Or I tell people, when you go to a competition, you should have one touch, at least one touch that you have made or has been scored on you that you're going to savor at least for the next 24 hours. And there are touches that I am still savoring. Like last Nationals, 2019 Nationals, I was against a gal from Rhode Island, and I've been hitting her since I was in the juniors. She's about 3 inches taller than me. She's a higher rated fencer than I am. Score goes 4-all, and time has run out. So you do a 1 minute sudden death.
Okay.
She's got priority. Actually, I'm not sure. I may have had priority. Priority means if after 1 minute nobody scores, the person with priority wins 4-all.
Okay.
When she's aggressive, she scored. When I'm aggressive, I score. And I kind of just hold back just enough. She makes an action. I pick up her blade and I go over her back and try and tap her on the back. And this is a woman who's taller than me. And it didn't feel like I'd hit. So she starts coming out and I come on back to pick her up again and try to go out, and the referee calls halt. I'm like, why are you calling halt? It just points to the scoring machine. I'm like, oh my God. I get off strip. One of my buddies who I've known since high school, he's from originally from New Orleans, or Baton Rouge, excuse me. I'm like, yo, John, was that touch really as cool as it felt? He's like, oh yeah.
That's excellent.
I don't hit people on the back very often at my height. Oh, bing!
That is wonderful. Congratulations. A little belatedly, but congratulations.
Well, the PS on that is she would end up finishing third and I would finish up sixth. We'd both make the finals.
Okay. Very, very good. Well, it's a pleasure to hear about these fencing adventures and everything that's going on. And good luck with navigating the rest of the pandemic. We all hope it ends soon, but you know, even if it doesn't, we figured some things out.
Well, I can tell you that if any of your people watching this video would like to come fence at Cyrano's Place in Lakewood, we are doing beginner classes by family friend pods. So I'm telling people to come, call me up, bring up to a group of six. We'll keep you in your own class and schedule you accordingly and get you through and teach you the class, because I got to keep people safe and divided. But this is how I've reinvented the club. Mm-hmm. So, but I still need, come on, fencing. The world revolves around fencing. They just don't know it yet.
Well,
and
yeah.
I'm out.
And what's up with that, Sarah? All right. right. On that note, I want to just give all of the locations and your contact information. Sierra Nose Place Fencing Club is located at 15639 Madison Avenue in Lakewood, Ohio. For more information, call 216-227-DUAL, which is 3835, or email info@sierranoseplace.info. All right. And of course, Sierra Nose Place YouTube videos can be enjoyed from anywhere, all over the world. So congratulations on all those. I look forward to seeing more. I've now become a subscriber, and I encourage everyone to subscribe because they are fun. And you do learn things, and you get moved and also tickled by them, too. So thank you so much for being on, Sarah. It's been a pleasure. This is Kate Thomas with At Home Radio. Until next time, let's go fencing.
It's a touchy subject.
Ha ha ha.